Okay. Thanks a lot to CISPA for giving me this opportunity. My present talk deals with the role played during the years 1957-2013 by the Italian physicist Franco Celleri in the international scientific and epistemological debate on particle physics, foundation of quantum mechanics, and foundation of relativity theory. The aim has been to reconstruct Celleri's role from a historiography point of view, investigating his scientific activity in the three above research areas and the historical, social, and political context in which he fully operated, since one of my goals was to underline how these contexts were related to his scientific approach. It's basically a very short glance of my PhD dissertation in history of science. Of course, due to time, my speech is turning out to be a merely tentative presentation, definitely not true at all. What prompted me? Sometimes in history of science, it sounds intriguing to try to shed some light on the real relevance of some unusual directions and research programs that have neither left a permanent trace nor been appreciated at all. Franco Celleri was a remarkable character, but he has not been fully analyzed yet. His figure and activity are quite known, but little studied by historians of physics. My main motivation lay in being the first to have access to his whole unclassified archives, which are stored at Celleri's family home in Bari at the present. Franco Celleri's private archive had neither been analyzed yet, nor organized so far. As to underline the importance of his archives, I found some letters sent in 2003 by Oliver Freire Jr. and John Lees Bromberg, and by Spencer Wirth and Joseph Anderson to the physics department of Bari. They highlighted the importance of the relevant historical materials found in Celleri's documents during the pivotal interview made by Freire himself in June 2003, and gave some tips in order to preserve all documents for an available use, also finding a host to preserve his private papers. There are some activities Celleri made. You can see the number of published papers and books and the huge correspondence he had with a lot of scholars and scientists all over the world, the Broglie, Popper, Gammer, Stuart Bell, Bohm, and others. You can see there. He made a lot of lectures in high school and university and with a lot of popularization papers and books. And he attended it 130 international and national conferences, and he organized a lot of them, attended by the elite of scholars of the time. Here the sources I utilized in my PhD dissertation. And here are some outcomes I found. Being fully aware of the potentially decisive importance, but also the possible risk associated with memories and recollection, I decided to use oral interviews too, in order to collect a record from several scientists, which would allow me to understand the real effect of Franco Celleri's life and activity on the debate on particle physics, foundation of quantum mechanics, and foundation of relativity theory. The whole thesis is full of quotations as to directly testify my conclusions. As regard concerning this, I found the influences Celleri's talk about in his high school, like Professor Aldo Graffi, in his university, like Professor Dario Graffi, Antonio Pignedoli, Gian Pietro Puppi, and some scholars that were an influence in his choices. These are some outcomes. In particle physics, I found his degree thesis that is present only in his archives, being absent even in the University of Bologna, where he graduated. Celleri spent 2 years at CERN, and during his research in particle physics, he developed the peripheral model with Bonsignori and the one-pion exchange model. And Celleri made 6 papers on the non-conservation of the angular moment in weak iterations. This created a great deal of interest in the world. There's a huge correspondence on the matter with Vittorio Silvestrini, Emilio Segre, Carlo Rubbia, John Bell, as well as some evidences recollected in some interviews with Francesco Guerra, for example, and the failure of the model after the acceptance of the German octet. This is the peripheral model. It consists in neglecting all interaction but the one between the incoming particle and the single pion of the neutron cloud, if you are studying the single pion production in collision of a generic particle A on a target nucleon. This is the one pion exchange, accelerated here. In some inelastic processes, really what is going on is that one pion exchange. And this is the non-conservation of angular momentum. Franco hypothesized this model that resolved the problems of CP violation in the decay of chaos. But of course, abandoned that thought because Gell-Mann's octet came out and he won the Nobel Prize in 1969. The Selle's model was based on spurion, and of course, after the discovery of Gell-Mann, was no longer be accepted. He spent 2 years in the USA, choosing between five universities and five applications. He received five positive answers. He stayed in a corner with Beta, but after these 2 years, he decided to come back to Italy. He worked at Bologna University, but then he shifted to University of Bari. He had an experience, a strange experience, in a Swedish company, Scanditronics, which produced magnets and coils for particle accelerators for medical research and industrial application. During his stay in USA, he declared to the interview to Freire that in 1965, he started to develop a critical attitude towards contemporary physics. It was soon evident that there were problems, fundamental problems in physics. The problems in elementary particle physics for Celery were due to the fact that quantum mechanics is poorly understood and anyway is a very abstract idea. Here is some matter for his moving from Bologna to Bari. Bologna University was in trouble in physics at the time concerning Celery's thought, had made mistakes in the choice of people to head the Physics Institute, and so was strongly reflected in the climate, political and cultural one. In Bari, human relationships were much relaxed. Celery was the first theoretical physics in Bari University, and so he had space to do what he wants. And he had no great difficulties in doing foundation of quantum mechanics. In Bologna, before coming to Bari, Celery stated, I started saying I didn't believe anymore that quantum mechanics was correct, and the reactions were strongly negative. Here are some other outcomes. The Bernard Despagnat's books was maybe the main important reason for his Celery shift to quantum mechanics. Celery declared to know this book in 1971, but I found with a lot of research that the real years in 1966, and this is good because in 1969, as I'm going to explain later, during the Council in Italian Physical Society, Celery proposed the Varenna School in 1970, being completely new of the Bernard Despagnat books. I analyzed the deep link between his scientific activity and his social and political one. With several confirmations, I've shown how Celery's political and philosophical beliefs were the foundations of his choices in physics research. And I have some statement by Celery. I would just like to add that my choice didn't spring up from an arrogant attitude, but from a deep compliance with the mass criticism against scientism that emerged with the student movement in the late 60s and early 70s. It's therefore evident that for dialectical materialist, as Celery was, the position of the opponents of the quantum mechanics is more correct than that of the creators. Celery spent 2 years in Nebraska This day played a key role in his political awareness, providing a crucial basis of Celery's approach to foundation of quantum mechanics. And concerning this, he declared that in a great letter to J. Monnet, I'm a former elementary particle physicist who saturated his mind for 10 years with complex angular momentum calculation, with the analytical properties of the S matrix and other similar junk. Then the influence of the student movement first and later the Italian Communist Party led me to a self-critical reflection and a crisis. You can't imagine the sense of liberation that one feels in going out of oneself, looking at what one is and what one has done in a new way, seeing its enormous narrowness and at the same time the anger for having spent so much energy within a very narrow cultural tunnel without light, as particle physics was in his thought. I've committed myself over the last 2 years to trying to fill the enormous cultural gaps that I have because of the compulsory sterile super specialization that I had and was forced to. I was struck by lightning in the USA, in Nebraska, when I read a Marxist-Leninist treaty published in the Soviet Union, he found in Nebraska. Everything became clear in the light of the contradiction between materialism and idealism. So there is no doubt that dialectical materialism fascinates me, even though I'm unable to face the criticism, maybe only for a matter of ignorance. Here, other confirmation of his stay in Nebraska. I can easily call myself a materialist and atheist, but with Marx, real or not real, there is an insurmountable problem, that of historicism. Real Marxism was a philosophical breakup and that anticipated and prepared the political, economic, and civil breakdown of the societies of real socialism. Real Marxism is conventionalism and historicism. It's a rip-off. Of course, you can see that there's we are in the 90s, so with historical events, he changed a little bit his position, but he declared himself as a materialist, anti-imperialist, anti-capitalist, sympathizer of the Rifondazione Comunista Party. And of course, he was influenced by Lenin, Engels, and Mao, but less of Marx. His way to do physics stay in the strong connection between the ideas of a renewal of society and of physics that have to go together. As I told, Celery was a counselor in the steering committee of the Italian Physical Society in 2 years, and he made a lot of proposals. The organization of Varena Summer School in 1970, the first in foundation of quantum mechanics and in history of physics. He proposed and supported the withdrawal of the NATO funds to Varena Summer School, and he took care to bring proposals to solve the problems of the SIF magazine in Nuovo Cimento in that years. His proposal was prior to the role played by Marcello Sini, I found, whose role in the decision is instead overestimated by several scholars. Sini received the task of reading the book by Despagnat, already known by Celery, and to report on it at the following meeting. Here, other outcomes I found, there's a lot. Only one thing. In the 70s and the 80s, it was really difficult to do foundational quantum mechanics in physics institutes and departments. In Bari first, but here I found some letter that confirmed that in USA it was really difficult to do foundational quantum theory in the physics department. Yeah, for examples. Celery spent his last part of studies in the foundation of relativity theory, doing a new theory, weak relativity, and because he found a medium for the idea of really waves, the ether, but the ether seen by Einstein after 1920, for example. It was influenced by Prokhovnik, Bell, Bilder, as I told at the beginning. So, this is conclusion. By 1969, I had come to the conclusion that there was something basically wrong in the way theoretical physics was practiced. Too much high mathematics. Okay.
So thank you, Luigi, for your talk. We have time for a few questions. Roberto.
Thank you very much for your presentation. It's a very fascinating personality. Could you please tell us, I mean, what would be your final conclusion about this pattern, this biography in connection between politics and physics? What is your final conclusion on your work?
Yes, I decided to speak specifically about this matter because there's a lot of correspondence in which Celery deeply underscore his totally connection with his political and philosophical ideas, with the way in which he researched, with the way in which he opposed to the to quantum mechanics and relativity theory, two theories that Celery recognized as the best maybe theories in the 20th century, but he wanted to find the through, he wanted to resolve some negative statements behind these theories. And his way to accept the philosophical and political ideas of his pattern was completely maybe the main reason to research in this way, in this way.
Thanks
to you.
Thank you, Luigi. Is there any other question?
Well, if I may at this point, I mean, don't you think that is, I mean, the failure of his approach, he dedicated so much time on the Mollendo argument, the reconciliation, the failure, which was scientific, but also despite professional, at a certain point had a role in its turning to the quantum foundation problem?
Yeah, I don't want to overestimate Celery's figure. Nor I won't intend to create a memorial of his figure. He recognized his failures in a professional, scientific way, but he wanted to try some road of beating the track because he thought that something was not perfect in the theories, and so he found and abandoned a lot of different patterns, and well. We could do a great analysis against his failure, but I'm convinced that in the history of physics, history of science, it's important to investigate also this pattern without some good results, because as I try to demonstrate, Celery contribute to this debate in the 20th century, in my opinion.
Thank you, Luigi.
Thank you all.
Now we